everyone at home. Welcome to DGCSE biology lesson. Today we are looking at enzymes. So you found that if you want to speed up a chemical reaction in chemistry, you can just add a chemical catalyst, right? And then if you come to biology, you find that you are dealing with living things. And then if you look at the body of these living things, every time reactions are taking place. Now the question is, if you want to speed up these chemical reactions, what can you do? Can you add the catalyst from chemistry? You can't do that because you know it's going to poison your body. So there is what we call biological catalyst, which speed up chemical reactions in our body. And then this catalyst, they are proteins in their nature, and we call them the enzymes. So these are proteins. Which act as biological catalyst. So basically, this is what speeds up reactions in your body. Now, let's look at the properties of these enzymes. One, enzymes are sensitive to temperature. Secondly, enzymes are sensitive to pH. And then thirdly, enzymes do not get used up in a reaction. And then fourthly, enzymes are substrate specific. So if you look at the illustrations here, this shows an enzyme, and then this is what we call a substrate. So you find that if you look at the active site of this enzyme, this is the active site. If you look at the active site of this enzyme, it conforms to the shape of the substrate. And then if you look at this other enzyme again, it also conforms to its substrate. So this means there is no way this enzyme can combine with this substrate, because if you look at their shapes, they are not the same. So this enzyme will go with this substrate, and then this enzyme will go with that substrate. That's why we are saying they are substrate specific. And because of this substrate specificity, we say enzymes operate in a lock and key manner, because you know that each and every lock has its own key. So each and every enzyme has its own substrate, and you know that it is not every key that can unlock any lock. So it is not any substrate that can bind to any enzyme. That's why we are saying they operate in a lock and key manner. And then let's look at the types of enzyme catalyzed reactions, and this one is strictly for pure biology. So you find that we have two types of reactions as enzymes are catalyzing them. The first reaction, if you look here, we have our enzyme again, right? And then we have our substrate. So they will combine to form an enzyme substrate complex. And then if you look at this side, we will have our enzyme again. Remember I said they do not get used up in the reaction. That's why we have this enzyme here. And then look at this product from here. Look at the appearance of the substrate, and then look at the product now. You can see that now this substrate, it was a unit, but this time around it has been divided into two units. So if you're going to have a substrate as a unit, and then your product is more than one unit, we call this kind of reaction a catabolic reaction. And then let's go to case number two. We have your enzyme again, and then if you look at your substrate, it is divided into two units, and then they will come together forming the enzyme substrate complex again. Now let's look at our product. We started with two units as a substrate, and then our product now, it is just one unit. So this kind of reaction, we call it an anabolic reaction. So catabolic reaction, they will split your substrate into two units, and then your anabolic reaction, they will synthesize or build up your substrate into one unit. That's why you find your product that this time around, it is just one unit. Now let's go for classes of enzyme. Again, this is also for pure biology. So you find that enzymes can be classified into two. We have what you call the intracellular enzymes. These are enzymes which are produced inside a cell, and then they will also perform their function still inside the cell. We call them the intracellular enzymes. And then the other class is what we call the extracellular enzymes. So these ones, they will be produced in a cell, and then they will be released to the environment or outside the cell, and then they will do their function out there. So they are called the extracellular enzymes. Now let's move to the effect of pH and temperature on enzyme activity. Remember I said enzymes are sensitive to pH and temperature. Now let's see the effects of pH and temperature on their activity. So this one is both for pure biology and science double award. So let's start with the effects of pH. If you look at this graph here, when the pH is increasing and also the enzyme activity increasing this side, you find that if you look at this graph, when the pH is low, there is no enzyme activity. This is because a lower pH will inactivate your enzyme. And then when you start to increase your pH, even the enzyme activity now starts to increase. This is because now, because you are increasing your pH, your enzyme start to become active. And then because it is active, that's when we start to see an activity. And then there is a point where we are going to have the highest activity. So this pH that gives you the highest enzyme activity, we call it the optimum pH. This is the pH which is most favorable, and this is the pH where the enzyme activity is high, meaning that the enzyme works at its best. And then a further increase in pH beyond the optimum pH, we are going to have now the enzyme activity going down, as you can see in this graph. This means now the enzyme is no longer working, and the reason is that as you increase pH beyond the optimum pH, we are going to have denaturation of the enzyme. Remember, I said an enzyme has an active site. So when you increase your pH, you are destroying this active site, and then we say an enzyme is denatured. And then when an enzyme is denatured, it cannot bind to its substrate. That's why now the activity goes down, because enzyme and the substrate, they cannot come together. Now moving on, there is the effect of temperature on enzyme activity. Again, if you look at this graph, when the temperature is low, there is no enzyme activity. Zero temperature, zero enzyme activity. This is because at low temperatures, enzymes are inactive. And when they are inactive, there is no way they can catalyze any reaction. And then as you increase your temperature, even the enzyme activity start to increase. This is because now this is when the enzymes start to be active. And then there's going to be a point where the enzyme activity is at the highest level. And then that temperature, which gives the highest enzyme activity, we call it the optimum temperature. This is the most favorable temperature. And then when you expose enzyme to their favorable temperature, they work at their best level. As you can see here, this is the best level of enzyme activity for this enzyme. And then a further increase beyond the optimum temperature, we are going to have the enzyme activity now decreasing again. Same, remember when you're talking about pH, we said an increase over the optimum pH will denature the enzyme. The same applies to temperature. An increase beyond the optimum temperature will denature your enzyme. So we are going to have the same thing happening, denaturation of the active site. And then when the active site is denatured, it means this substrate cannot bind to their enzyme. And then the absence of binding means there is no way an enzyme can catalyze a reaction. So at low temperatures, enzyme is inactive, hence no activity. As the temperature starts to increase, the enzyme also starts to be active, and then we start to have an activity, as we can see. And then at the optimum temperature, this is the most favorable temperature, and the enzyme activity is at its best. And then a further increase in temperature beyond the optimum, we are going to have the enzyme activity now decreasing, because the enzyme has been denatured. That's all I had for you on enzymes. We'll see you again in the next lesson.